Welcome to the City Impact Church podcast. Join us weekly to listen to sermons from our Sunday services or our special events. For more information, visit cityimpactchurch.com or find us on our Facebook page. We pray you'll be inspired and challenged by this week's message.
Okay, let's get into it tonight.
Enough fooling around. I want to talk tonight, if you want to title, it's called Language of the Giants. How many remember the program Land of the Giants? Those of us who are old enough. Okay. How many have watched the BFG? Big Friendly, thank you. How many have watched Jack and the Beanstalk? Got the picture. So I've been doing this series. I actually preached this word a long time ago, maybe when I had hair. And I've been redoing it. And what would took one night to preach, I'm now into week number 5. And I've been doing this series on the language of the giants because when you look at how a giant speaks, it reflects a mindset and a certain type of thinking. Often we think of giants, and of course we all understand that we can all face giants in our world, and sometimes we have a negative connotation of giants, that there's something big, ugly, hairy, smelly. Could be the person next to you. No. And you can have giants in your world, but I want to flick it around, because that is true, giants can come into our world, but I want to show you tonight that God actually created us and ordained us to be giants in the land. And so I want to just deal with that thinking. And so I've got 7 things actually that represent the language of a giant. I'm just going to give you one tonight. I just think you can only handle one. It's a big one. But I pray tonight that while we're finished, that you'll somehow get a mindset that you're the giants. Because what I'm finding is a lot of Christians, if you don't see yourself as a giant, you won't actually think you can actually make a difference. I mean, I've challenged our church. You know, some of them, you may have an altar call, and I'll just encourage people to come up and just join me on the prayer line, and I can see them struggling to pray. And so then I'm thinking, if you can't pray with family, I know you're not doing it out there, which is where we should be. People in our workplace, people at the mall, people wherever we go, there's people that need the power of God. There's people that need a demonstration of God's love. But if you don't see yourself as a giant in the land, you're not going to be proactive in the way you speak or act. Is that helping anybody? So let me just kick off with a scripture. I just started this last Sunday night. I actually wrote this when I was not at the gym, but I got all this at the gym. But in Matthew chapter 8, verse 23, we'll see how we go tonight. Matthew chapter 8, verses 23 to 27, reading out of the Passion Translation. It's for the TPT. How many reading the Passion? Wow, obviously no one, because there's no passion. They all got into a boat and began to cross over to the other side of the lake. Jesus, exhausted, fell asleep. Suddenly a violent storm developed with waves so high that the boat was about to be swamped. You've got to realize, these are fishermen. It's a major storm. It's a lake. It's not even a sea. It's crazy. I've been there. How many have been to the Lake of Galilee? It's not even that big. We've got bigger lakes. Well, we have in the South Island anyway. Yet Jesus continued to sleep soundly. The disciples woke him up saying, Lord, save us. Well, save us, Lord. We're going to die. But Jesus reprimanded them. Why are you gripped with fear, you coronavirus? Why are you gripped with fear? Bit more pump up here in the foldback, please. Just crank that up. Otherwise, I'll strain my voice. Why are you gripped with fear? Where is your faith? Then he stood up, rebuked the storm, and said, be still. And instantly it became perfectly calm. And the disciples were astonished by this miracle and said to one another, who is this man? Who is this masked man? He said, he wasn't wearing a mask. Even the wind and the waves obey him. As I was reflecting on this, I began to understand and see that faith is actually connected to your identity. Now, I've never really heard that or really thought about that, but as I'm reading that, I'm thinking your ability of who you think you are will determine your level of faith. Am I helping anybody? So your ability to have faith, your ability to speak to a storm, to a giant, to a mountain, or a devil, or any situation in your world is connected to your ability to know who you are in Christ. Come on now. So here the disciples are in Jesus' boat. Well, they're in a boat. Jesus is in the boat. Most of them are fishermen. They're in a storm, so they understand what that's like. But they are fearing for their lives, and so they wake Jesus up. They cry out to him, save us, we're going to die. Fascinating. But the first thing Jesus does when he wakes up is that he tells them off. He rebukes them, not the storm, he rebukes them, and says to them, where's your faith? In other words, why didn't you do something? Why didn't you stand up in the boat and speak to the storm? Now, I guess, if I had been there, I most probably would have thought, I didn't realize I could. I'm a fisherman. I'm a tax collector. I'm a doubter. You mean I could have done something about the situation? So then Jesus stands up, and he speaks to the waves, and he speaks to the wind to shut up. It's in the Greek. Be still in Greek is shut up. Instantly, there's a calm. I'm helping you tonight. Here comes a giant now. Whoa. Mate. You always... Sorry. And the disciples, listen now, they're astonished. They are absolutely blown away. Who is this man? Who is he that even the wind and the sea obey him? Who is he? Now, Jesus knew who he was. We read the scriptures. We know who he was. He was the Son of God. We think, Jesus can do that. God can do that. But the jury was still out as far as the disciples were concerned of just who Jesus really was. I mean, they'd heard him say a few things that maybe he was the bread of heaven and he was the way, the truth, and the life, and that God was his father. But really, they didn't really put the dots together that when he speaks to a storm and it listens to him, they're beginning to wonder, oh my goodness, who is this man that's in our boat that the wind and the sea listen to him? I'm trying to help you tonight that you're the giant in the land. Let's go to another scripture, John chapter 5, verses 14 to 18. A short time later, Jesus found the man at the temple. This guy had been crippled for 38 years. He found him in the temple. He told him actually to pick up his bed and walk. And said to him, look at you now, you are healed. Walk away from your sin so that nothing worse will happen to you. Then the man went to the Jewish leaders because the Jewish leaders had asked him, what are you doing carrying your bed around on the Sabbath day? And you're not allowed to do that on the Sabbath day. No work was to be done on the Sabbath day. And this guy, Jesus had told to pick up his bed and carrying it. So they said, what are you doing carrying your bed around on the Sabbath day? And Jesus said, the crippled man said, well, I don't know. The guy who told me to get up and has healed me, he's the guy that told me to carry his bed. And they said, well, who is he? And of course, Jesus being the type of guy that he was, he didn't tell anybody who he was. Well, I'm just a random. Pick up your bed. So now Jesus has met him and telling him, giving him a bit further instruction, he says, I'm the guy, I'm Jesus. So the man went to the Jewish leaders to inform them. It was Jesus who healed me. So from that day forth, the Jewish leaders began to persecute Jesus because of the things he did on the Sabbath. Idiots. Jesus answered his critics by saying, every day. Every day. Even when I don't see it, you never stop. You never stop. Every day, my Father is working. Now, let me just pause here because I use this all the time now. So I say to the Holy Spirit, well, there's going to be someone here tonight that needs a miracle. There's someone here tonight that needs a breakthrough. There's someone here tonight that needs a healing. There's someone here tonight that needs a prophetic word, a word of encouragement. There's someone in your world when you go to work tomorrow, when you go to school tomorrow, wherever you go tomorrow, there's someone that needs the power of God into their life. And God is always working. But the problem is, do you see yourself as a person able to connect with God and move with God and be a conduit for God's power to flow and move through your life? So Jesus said, my Father, he's always Well, thank you. You're with me. Every day my father's at work and I will be too. This infuriated them and made them all the more eager to devise a plan to kill him, because that's what religious people do. For not only did he break the Sabbath rules, but he called God my father, which made him what? So if you're born again here tonight and you've given your life to Jesus and you call God your father, guess what? You've just made yourself equal with God. You've just come into a God class of being. Anybody call God their father? Some of you are not sure. Anybody calling God their father? What are you? What are you? You're a giant. That's what you are. You're a giant. Turn to the person next and say, hey. Keep going. John chapter 10, verses 31 to 35. This is just entree. This is just the entree. We're getting there. Jesus is having another problem again with some religious leaders. When they heard this, the Jewish leaders were so enraged that they picked up rocks to stone him to death. We got any rocks tonight? Anybody carrying a stone? Rightio. They picked up rocks to stone him to death. But Jesus said, my Father has empowered me to work many miracles and acts of mercy among you. So which one of them do you want to stone me for? Good question. The Jewish leaders responded, we're not stoning you for anything good you did. It's because of your blasphemy. You're just a son of Adam. You're just a Daryl Watson, the eldest son of John and Glenda Watson. Off the farm at Monkey Island, Arapuki in Western Southland at the bottom of the planet. Very bottom. You're just a son of Adam. You're just Mary's boy. We know your family. We grew up with your brothers and sisters. You're claiming to be something. You're claiming to be a giant. You're claiming to be the son of God. You're claiming that God's your father. That's blasphemy. How dare you? Jesus answered, isn't it written in the scriptures that God said you are? So I want you to turn to the person next and say, I am a God. Okay. You're struggling a little bit. I want you to turn to the person on the other side and say, I am a God. Anybody struggling with this whole concept right here? Yeah, there's a few. Okay. It'll take a while. But if I can shift you this much tonight, that'll be something. I'm going somewhere. Jesus says, isn't it written in your scriptures that God said you are gods? Little g, not big G, little g. The scripture cannot be denied. It cannot be broken. It cannot be found in error. So what God has declared you are, that's what you are. It doesn't matter what you feel like or what you think, that's what you are. See, the problem is we're not seeing ourselves as God sees us. Therefore, we don't act and speak like giants in the land. Now, I'm going somewhere, but I'm just trying to help you tonight. So if those who have the message of the scriptures, the guy that's carrying the Bible, he's got the Bible with him. You carry the scriptures, and the scriptures are telling you that you are gods, then why would you accuse me of blasphemy? That's a good question. So once again, Jesus knows his identity, and faith and miracles are flowing out of that. Because he sees himself as a giant. He's the son of God. We understand it, but we understand it. But God is saying, you're the son of God. God has said to you. Now, he's quoting the scripture out of Psalm 82. So let's go there, will we? Psalm 82. This is where Jesus is quoting from. Verses 1 to 6. God stands in the congregation of the mighty. God stands where? In the congregation. So God stands in this place tonight. So turn to the person next and say, I am mighty. Say it with a bit of conviction. God stands in the congregation of the mighty. Thank you. He judges amongst the little g. He judges amongst the gods. Still with me? Then he says to them, how long will you judge unjustly and show partiality to the wicked? Selah, pause and think. This is what I love. The reason that God has made you gods or you are giants in the land is for this reason. Defend the poor. Defend the fatherless. Do justice to the afflicted and the needy. Deliver the poor and the needy. Free them from the hand of the wicked. In other words, what God's saying is, see, God hates oppression at any level. Whether it's sickness, whether it's disease, whether it's this abortion thing that this government's trying to push through against life. I was just praying, God, let our politicians have a sense. We should be passing laws that promote life. Just life. Every Christian should be for life. Jesus said, I came to give you life. So every Christian should be promoting life. So God's against, because we're made in the image and likeness of God. So God hates oppression in any level, whether it's poverty, whether it's fatherless or brokenness or oppression or weakness or mental health or suicide or depression or anxiety or fear or addiction, whatever that is, God hates it. But God says, I've made you a giant. I've made you my son. I've empowered you to go out and to do something. But often we don't see ourselves as giants. So we thought, well, what can I do? What can I do? I'm just a son of Adam. I'm just flesh and blood. God says, no, you're not. I stand in the congregation of the mighty. I said, I stand in the congregation of the mighty, God says. I judge amongst the gods. Right, I better keep moving. Verse 5, this is what I see. They do not know, nor do they understand. All these people walking around in darkness, and all the foundations of the earth are unstable. Do you know why the foundations of the earth are unstable? Because the sons of God and the daughters of God won't rise up and be who God's called them to be. You've got to understand that when Jesus hung and died on a cross, he redeemed humanity. He didn't redeem the earth. The sons of God, it's your job to redeem the earth. I'm trying to help somebody, please. Verse 6, I said, you are, just in case you didn't get it, and all of you are children of the Most High. Turn to the person next and say, I'm a giant. Right, let's get into it tonight. 1 Samuel chapter 17. That was just the entree. Are you ready? 1 Samuel chapter 17, verses 4 to 11. Then Goliath, a Philistine champion from Gath, came out of the Philistine ranks to face the forces of Israel. He was over 9 feet tall, around about 3 meters. He wore a bronze helmet, and his bronze coat of mail weighed 125 pounds, roughly around 58 kilos. Anybody in this room tonight weighing in at 58 kilos? Oh, I see a couple of hands go up. I'm weighing at the moment around about 93.4 kilos, around about 205 pounds of raw Southland beef. Anyway. Goliath is standing at 3 meters tall. He's got a bronze helmet, bronze coat of mail weighing 125 pounds, around about 58 kilos. He's also got bronze leg armor. He carried a bronze javelin. Everything's bronze, you realize? In other words, it glistened in the sun like my head. Just trying to paint a picture for you. The shaft of his spear was heavy and as thick as a weaver's beam. Anybody ever seen a weaver's beam? No one's got any idea what a weaver's beam is. I actually looked up what a weaver's beam was. It's around about 70 mil thick. 70 mil. Around about 2.5 to 3 inches. For those of us who are working old enough to understand metric and imperial. Still with me? Shaft of a spear was thick and heavy as a weaver's beam, tipped with an iron spearhead that weighed 15 pounds, round about 6 point something kilos, was just the head of the spear. Trying to help you tonight. Turn to the person next and say, I'm a giant. His armor bearer walked ahead of him carrying a shield. Goliath stood and shouted a taunt across the Israelites. Why are you coming out to fight? He called. Sorry, Yes, why are you all coming out to fight? He called, I am the Philistine champion, but you are only the servants of Saul. In other words, you guys are losers. That's Greek. That's Greek for I'm the winner, you're the loser. Choose one man to come here and fight me. If he kills me, then we'll be your slaves. But if I kill him, you'll be our slaves. I defy the armies of Israel today. Send me a man who will fight me. And when Saul and the Israelite army heard this, they were terrified and deeply shaken. Number one, and the only one I'm going to give you on the language of the giants tonight, you need to write this down, is that giants intimidate. Giants intimidate. Giants, by definition, are bigger than anybody else. And the Bible goes into great lengths to give us the height and the weight of Goliath's armor, the dimensions of his weapons. Why? Because to look at, when he comes out in front of that Philistine army, he is an intimidating picture. Over 3 meters tall. I mean, he is ripped. He is some machine. I mean, his spear, you wouldn't want that thing going through you. That's going to leave a hole. 6-point-something kilos of metal going through you. You got to understand the weight of his armor. He is impenetrable. Even if you got close to him, you wouldn't penetrate that armor. You wouldn't get through him. Even if you went for a leg shot, he's got armor on his legs. His thighs are ripped. They are bulging. This man is a man mountain. He is an intimidating force. Am I helping anybody tonight? So the Bible goes to lay that paint this picture that Goliath is an intimidating figure. And the whole army of the Israelites is in fear and trembling. But as he comes out, this is what Goliath does. Goliath intimidates. So what he does is he begins to tell everybody, this is how the battle's going down. This is how it's going to go down. This is how we're going to fight this thing. Now, what I don't understand is, why didn't a couple of thousand Israelites just say, why don't we rush them? See, what fascinates me is, why do we buy into the giants in our lives trying to dictate to us how life is supposed to be, how your world's supposed to be, how this government's supposed to be, how our nation's supposed to be, how the young people are supposed to be? Why do we listen to the voices that try to tell us, this is your past, this is where you come from, this is your weaknesses, this is your addictions, you can't do any more? Why do we allow the giants in our world to intimidate when God says, I've called you to be a giant, and I want you to begin to set the tone, I want you to begin to set the atmosphere, I want you to begin to tell the devil how this thing goes down. I'm preaching better than you're responding, by the way. But that's okay, because I'm a giant. I will set the tone. So we're the giants. We're the sons of God. We intimidate. We declare how it's going to be. We declare a move of God in our nation. We declare a revival. We declare a generation coming out of anxiety, fear, and depression. We're here to change the spiritual climate. I love this concept. Out of all the concepts or the languages of the giant, I love this one about intimidating. Because when I'm playing a card game, or any game where we've got to keep score, I try to get the scorecard. I've got a good mathematical brain, so I can. But there's another reason. So when we're putting down everybody's names, my name goes down first. But I never put Daryl on the piece of paper, because what would a giant put down? Winner. So I put down winner. I might put you down as loser. or any other name, but not winner. So what am I doing? I'm intimidating, I'm setting the tone, and telling you, regardless of how this game's going to go, I'm the winner. That's maybe a reason why people don't want to play games with me. I don't know, but I'm just... Giants intimidate. It's the same when I'm playing with my grandkids. We're playing board games or whatever, and you see it, and snakes and ladders or whatever, rolling dice, and I call on the cosmos. I blow on the dice, and I speak over it what I want. I say, I want a 6. And my grandkids are fascinated that whatever granddad speaks over the dice, it comes. So then they try it. But that's just me. I'm an intimidator. I speak over things. I determine it, how it's going to go. I set the tone. I set the atmosphere. In the midst of all the fear and the uncertainty that's going on, why don't you set the tone? Whatever you're facing in your world, why don't you set the tone? Why don't you tell the devil how it's going to outcome? Why don't you begin to prophesy over your world? Why don't you get a promise of God and put it into your mouth and begin to speak and declare over your situation and see the power of God go to work in your world? Be the giant and intimidate. So we're giants in the land. I hate the way this world, I go to the odd rugby game and I watch all these young men sort of got a shirt hanging out, got to be swearing, got to be drinking a spates because you're a Southern man, you're not a Southern man unless you drink spates. But fascinates me how this world tries to intimidate a young man and a young woman. Of this is what it, this is what you have to be a young man and a young woman. You've got to be able to swear, you've got to be able to drink, you've got to be able to sleep around, do drugs or whatever. Let me tell you this, a real man, a real woman is measured by the obstacle it takes to stop him. So my question tonight is, what's stopping you from being the person that God's called you to be? Come on, what's stopping you from fulfilling your God-given destiny and potential? And I've been to enough, I've worked in enough workplaces, and I've been in there on Monday morning, and the guys come in from the weekend, and they try and tell me how much they drank, and I'm thinking there, is that it? Is that all you've got? Is that all you've got to brag about being a man? How much alcohol you drunk for the weekend? And yet somehow our society is like a giant that's shouting out an intimidation and trying to set the tone over our culture, of our young people, of our young men and our young women, that you've got to sleep around to be loved and accepted. But I'm here to tell you that God wants you to rise up and be giants in the land and begin to set the tone that no, we're God-fearing people. Let me tell you what a real man looks like and a real woman. They're in the house of God. They're passionate about the cause and the purpose of God. They'll be here at Vision Weekend. Hallelujah. They'll be giving. They'll be contributing to the cause of Christ. They've got their hands lifted up. That's a real man and a real woman. But unfortunately, so many people are being intimidated and manipulated by a giant that's trying to tell them what you should do and how you should live to be a young man and a young woman. Tonight I'm going to pray for some people. I'm going to challenge you to be the giants in the land, and you set the tone for your generation. Have I got an amen tonight? Amen. So giants like to intimidate. They like to set the tone and the atmosphere. Where are we going? I love even David. Because you don't have to be giant physically to be a giant. David was a giant at 17. And David accepts Goliath's challenge. Goliath says, give me a man. Now you got to understand, in the red corner, standing at over 3 meters tall, weighing in at 465 pounds, the man, the mammoth, undefeated from his last 200 fights by knockout, 200-0, Goliath from Gath, in the blue corner, the shepherd's boy, 17 years old, a little bit on the scrawny side, only weighing in on the light side, 185 pounds, the youngest of eight. His record, 2-0, two fights, two wins. In the blue corner, it is David, the Bethlehite. Now listen to this. So Goliath, now listen to the language. Listen to the language. Keep the music going. So giant, David's coming out there. Goliath says to him, listen to that. Am I a dog? Give me some volume here. Am I a dog? Am I a dog? Did you come send this little stick out to me? Then this is what Goliath says to him. I'm going to rip your head off your shoulders. He's intimidating. He's telling David how this is going to go down. But the giant in a 17-year-old teenager He says, you come to me with a sword and a spear. But I'm here to tell you how this is going down. I'm here to tell you that I'm going to take your head off your shoulders, and I'm going to take it a step further, because once I'm finished with you, we're coming after every one of your ugly brothers that's behind you. And everybody will know there is a God in Israel who can save. Have I got any giants in the land? Have I got any giants in the land? Come on. Crank that up a bit. Come on. Why don't you get on your feet tonight? Come on, you're the giants. You're the giants. I don't know what's holding you. I don't know what's intimidating you tonight. It's time for you to shout back. It's time for you to declare how this thing's going down. Stop. You can keep standing. I want to show you something that even God, our Heavenly Father, had to deal with. In Psalm 93, verses 3 to 4, here it is. The chaos once challenged you. This is God now. This is what he faced in Genesis chapter 1, verse 2. He's created the earth. But a lot of scholars believe between verse 1 and verse 2 that Satan's rebellion was there. And through the earth and God's creation into chaos and darkness. And in verse 2, this chaos and this emptiness and darkness is upon the face of the deep. And as God looks at it, that chaos is shouting at him, trying to intimidate him, that you can't change this. You can't resurrect this. That your world, your love, your creation is destroyed, it's over. And there's nothing you can do about it. And the Bible says the chaos once challenged you. The raging waves lifted themselves over and over, high above the ocean's depths, letting out their mighty roar. Yet at the sound of your voice, they were all stilled by something, hopefully. Your might. What a majestic king filled with power. And God looks at this emptiness and this darkness and this void. And he speaks from what's within him. Because God is the ultimate giant. He is God. And he just spoke four words. Let there be light. And what was in him filled the emptiness. The chaos, the brokenness. And I tell our worship team or anybody that's on this platform in Invercargill all the time, I said, there's got it. You've got to fill a space. Not with this, not with this, not with this, not with lights, not with smoke. You better fill it from something that's in here. Because God spoke and filled the emptiness. Yeah, the team can come. Where are you? Filled the atmosphere. Seen a ripple right through the entire universe. So even God had to do what he's asking you to do tonight. I tell people all the time, life hasn't always gone well for God. Some people don't realize that. Your archangel leads a rebellion and takes a third of the angels. You create a man and a woman, the apex of your creation, put them on the earth, and the man commits high treason and sells out all the authority that you gave him to the devil. And then you come physically and walk this earth in human form, and you spend all night in prayer picking 12 men to carry your heart and your desire and your dream for all humanity. And one of those betrays you. And another one of your inner circle, one of three, denied three times that he ever knew you. And your own people that you worked miracles, that you feared, that you poured out your love, grace, and compassion, rejected you and put you on a cross. Life hasn't always gone good for God. But what I love about God is that he's big enough that regardless of the chaos and the turmoil and the blackness that faced humanity or faced the world, he could still on that cross say, Father, forgive them. They know not what they do. He could still minister life and blessing and hope into the midst of the darkness. It never stopped him from being a giant and telling this world how it's going to be. But tonight, God wants you to be that person. We got a global economy that's in a mess. We got people living in fear. Before this even happened, we got a whole generation that are riddled with anxiety and fear and depression. We live in one of the greatest countries on the planet. And yet we've never had a generation so filled with depression and anxiety and suicide. I'm thinking, dear God, what's going on in our world? We need some giants. I need some people that are going to stand up and pray and speak into the atmosphere. Release the power of God. Release the power of heaven. Speak life and freedom. Be the intimidator. Set the tone. Set the atmosphere. Tell this generation how it's going to be. Tell the devil how it's going to be. Tell the giants that are roaring at you how it's going to be. I've been there. I've been there with my own family. Many of you know my story. My son, Corey, he's such a great man of God and a heart for God, but it wasn't always like that. He's been the prodigal son, and up in Tiana doing his own thing. I had a few giants ringing me up. I had this guy ringing me up. He rang me up twice. He said, your son's out of control. You need to get up here. He's going to end up killing himself. And I'm thinking, he's 19 years old. He's an adult. What can I do? I can't physically stop him. But they didn't know that in the Garden of Eden, what I call the Garden of Eden, which is Queen's Park in Invercargill, my prayer closet, that I'd be in there, and I still declare this today, that no weapon fashioned and formed against my family can or shall prosper. That every one of my kids and their families are in the house of God, serving God with a hunger and a passion and a desire. And I've seen the power of God go to work in his life. I had a daughter try to threaten me at the age of 14. She's leaving home. I sat with her down in the lower basement of their house. Roberta didn't want to face it. She knew what was coming. She said, I can't handle it. And I'm down there, and here's this 14-year-old daughter, and as a dad, I'm thinking, I can't physically do anything. And she's threatening me, I'm going to leave home if you don't allow me to do what I want. I just want to go to church once a week. I don't want to. And I'm thinking, I knew where it was coming from. I just said, well, I can't change who I am. This is who we are. It's not something I do because I'm a pastor. This is who I am. And I said, I can't stop you leaving, but I want you to know that when you come back, nothing changes. Thankfully, that broke it. That broke it. She said, can't you just compromise a little bit? I said, I can't. I can't compromise on who I am. You see, she's trying to intimidate. She's trying to manipulate me to get me to shift. This is for you young people. Maybe some parents here tonight. What I've realized in life, it doesn't matter where you draw the line. You can draw it away over here and be quite hard. Or you can be lax, way down this end. I've just learned, doesn't matter where you draw the line, someone sooner or later ain't going to be happy with that. So you might as well be true to your convictions. Draw the line. Now we're not all yet. We've got a daughter to go. But nothing changes. I was down here tonight. You're singing the song Waymaker. I'm declaring no weapon fashioned or formed against my family or their families now can or shall prosper. Every one of my kids, and I named three of them that I'm praying for. There's only one kid, but there's some other partners there. Every one of them are in the house of God, serving God with a hunger and a passion. Why? Because I'm a giant. I set the tone. We set the atmosphere. We declare how it's going to be in Jesus' name.